Hello everyone, welcome to today's class. Today we will be looking at mini mock test on UPSC prelims. Okay, this is test 2. Today's test will be a test 2. Okay, so give me a moment here. Let me open the PDF. Hello everyone, today we will have a mini mock test for the upcoming prelims examination. Now before going on to the test itself, let me give you a brief introduction about myself as well as about Unacademy. See, my name is Aravind. I have completed my BE Mechanical Engineering in 2014 and I have almost 3 years of experience in teaching UPSC Civil Services, and I have experienced all stages of UPSC Civil Services, that is prelims, mains and an interview. Now my specialized subjects include polity, international relations and then current affairs. Now please do join this group under unacademy_aravind if you wish to know more about my class schedule, or if you have any doubts regarding my classes, you can ask in this group. So please do consider joining this group unacademy_aravind. Now what will you get by subscribing to Unacademy? See, by subscribing to Unacademy, you will get access to daily live classes where you get to watch videos made by top educators, and you can rewatch those videos and you can ask doubts then and there itself if you want. So these are the major advantages with Unacademy as a platform. And also Unacademy as a platform conducts live tests as well as quizzes almost on a daily basis, so that our students can test themselves based on the pattern set by UPSC. And importantly, almost all courses in Unacademy are structured courses. Okay, all courses in Unacademy are structured courses, so that the learning process for students becomes much easier. And then you will get unlimited access to videos concerned with a particular examination that you are subscribing for. So if a student is subscribing for UPSC, that particular student will get all videos concerned with UPSC examination with unlimited access. Now also Unacademy as a platform facilitates this exchange of ideas from top educators like Mrunal Patel, Ayush Sangir, Roman Saini, Mohit Gupta. All these people are some of the most experienced faculty and top educators in UPSC platform for the past few years, and Unacademy as a platform facilitates this exchange of information between top educators to students. Now students will hail from all over India. Okay, so that's a choice Unacademy provides you with. Doesn't matter where you are coming from, Unacademy, you can learn UPSC from Unacademy, from no matter what the place. And Unacademy also covers syllabus in a very comprehensive manner, so that every nook and corner of UPSC syllabus will be covered by Unacademy. Not only that, almost all syllabus matters, subjects will be covered by multiple faculty. So if you're not satisfied with one faculty, you can immediately switch over to another faculty. So it gives you a choice of choosing your own faculty. Okay, so Unacademy democratizes the learning process in that way itself. Okay, so that's another advantage of why you have to choose Unacademy. Now, if I suggest you download the Unacademy learning app, so that you can keep better track of your learning goals, how much time you are spending on Unacademy app. Okay, so how much time you have to spend to complete your daily goal, all these things you can better keep a track of yourself if you are downloading Unacademy learning app. Not only that, if your favorite teacher is about to take a class in Unacademy app, you will get immediate notifications in your cell phone. Okay, so whenever your favorite teacher is taking a class, so please download Unacademy learning app. It has advanced features which we cannot implement in our web application. Now, these are the amounts charged by An Academy for Plus platform. Alright, this is amounts charged by An Academy for Plus platform. These are very, very less compared to offline institutions. If for offline institutions, you'll be spending upwards of 4 to 5 lakh rupees for 1 year. Okay, which includes fees, rent, food, all those things. But with An Academy, not only the upfront cost, that is fees, is very less. You will be saving a lot more money on your food as well as rental expenses, because you will be learning from the comfort of your home itself. Okay, so on top of the very meager sum that An Academy charges you, if you are using my code ARAVINDV, you will get 10% offer. So instead of paying 44,000 rupees for 1 year platform, you will be paying only 39,600 rupees. Okay. Now, An Academy has recently introduced Iconic platform. Now, under this Iconic platform, An Academy will assign you with a personal coach. Okay. Now, this personal coach is some of the most experienced faculty in UPSC platform, and so based on their experience as well as their know-how, they will guide you through the process of preparing UPSC. Now, even here, if you're using my code ARAVINDV, you will get 10% offer. Okay, so that's introduction and promotion done away with people. Now, let's move on to today's class. Okay, today's questions. This is the first question for today. This is the first question for today. Please give her an answer, okay? Okay, no one is giving the answer. Okay, so see, the answer for this question is D. Okay, the answer for this question is D. In the question itself is there, right? 4 balance sheet challenge. So there are 4 sectors under this problem. So, or normally sectors will be public sector, banks, non-banking financial companies, real estate sector, and Reserve Bank of India. So the answer for this question is D, 1, 2, and 3. Okay. The next question. Please give your answer for the next question. Okay, everyone, see here, the answer for this question is A. Neelam, sorry for that. The answer for this question is A. Okay, edge effect, it refers to the changes in population or community structures that occur at the boundary of 2 habitats. Okay, see, ecotones are often have a larger number of species and a larger population densities than communities on either side. Okay, so ecotone is a boundary. Ecotone is a boundary between the meeting point of two ecosystems. Okay, so in this ecotone region, it will have higher biodiversity compared to either two of these communities. Okay, this is termed as edge effect. Okay, now this tendency for increased biodiversity within ecotone is referred to as edge effect. Now, those species which occur primarily or most abundantly in ecotones are called as edge species. Although ecotone support an increase in density for some species, other species need interior habitat blocks to survive and show avoidance or poor survival on edges. An increase in anthropogenic fragmentation of landscape creates more ecotones, which may result in an increased occurrence of edge species while simultaneously resulting in increased negative effects for the interior species. So this is called as edge effect. Okay, on the boundary of meeting point of two ecosystems, diversity will be higher. Okay. Please give your answer for this question, people. Okay, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, Neelam and Gocham, both of you guys have given the correct answer. Congrats for that. Okay, see, mangroves are characteristic littoral plant formation of tropical and subtropical sheltered coastlines. Okay, mangroves are trees and bushes that grow below the high water level of spring tides, which exhibits a remarkable capacity to salt water tolerance. Now, they are basically evergreen land plants growing on sheltered shores, typically on tidal flats, deltas, estuaries, bays, creeks, and barrier islands. Mangroves have many special features for adapting to such stressful coastal environment. Mangroves occur in a variety of configurations. Some species, example Rhizophora, send arching prop roots down into the water, while others send vertical pneumoprotophoras or air roots up from the mud. Okay, this is called as viviparity mode of reproduction. Okay, it is called as aerial roots. Viviparity mode of reproduction, it happens salt glands in it is there, lenticulated bark, it is also correct. So the answer for this question is D. Now, most of the mangrove vegetation has lenticulated bark, which facilitates more water loss, produces coppices. Mangroves exhibit viviparity mode of reproduction, that is, seed germinate in the tree itself before falling to the ground. This is an adaptive mechanism to overcome the problem of germination in saline water. Some secrete excess salt through their leaves and some other block absorption of salts at their roots. The roots of some mangrove species, example Brugira gymnorrhiza and Candelia obovata, form into knees that project above the mud surface to facilitate gaseous exchange. Salt glands are present in the leaves of some of the mangrove species, example Aegiserus corniculatum. Salt glands are used to concentrate and actively excrete the absorbed salt so as to regulate the salt concentration inside the mangroves. Okay, so the answer for this question is D, everyone. Now please give your answer for this question. Please give your answer for this next question. Okay, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is C, mother goddess, each of whom is the female counterpart of the god. So that's the group called as Saptamatrikas. Okay, see, Saptamatrika refers to a group of seven mother goddess, each of whom is the Shakti or female counterpart of god. Okay, so if there is a god, all these Saptamatrikas, they will be considered as the female counterpart of god. Now they are Brahmani, wife of Brahmana, Maheshwari, wife of Shiva, Kumari, wife of Kumara, Vaishnavi, wife of Vishnu, Varahi, wife of Varaha, or the boar, an avatar or incarnation of Vishnu, Indrani, wife of Indra, Chamunda or Yami, wife of Yama. One text, the Varaha Purana, states that they number 8, including Yogeshwari, created out of flame from Shiva's mouth. Now recently the epigraphy branch of Archaeological Survey of India, they have recently discovered earliest epigraphic evidence of Saptamatrika cult. It is the earliest Sanskrit inscription discovered in South India as on date and was discovered in Cheburulu village in Guntur district of Andhra Pradesh. Okay. Please give your answer for this question. Give your answer for this question, everyone. Okay. Time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is A, World Economic Forum. Neelam, you are correct. Gocham, you are wrong, unfortunately. Neelam, you are right, obviously. The answer for this question is A, World Economic Forum. World Economic Forum releases this report called as Global Social Mobility Report of 2020. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question. Now, I believe similar to this question, I have explained one question in my previous examinations. Okay, so if you have attended my previous mock test, you can easily answer this question. Neelam, you have given the answer as D. Okay. Why, Neelam, you have deleted? Why did you delete the answer, Neelam? Okay. No, Neelam. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D, 1 and 4 only. You have given the correct answer and then you changed your answer, Neelam. That is not correct. Okay, see, if you look at the disqualification of MPs, it was discussed in Article 102. Okay, it was discussed in Article 102. Yes, according to Article 102, an MP can be disqualified based on three measures. One is under provisions of Article 102 itself. Provisions of Article 102 itself. Okay. Next one is anti-defection law. Anti-defection law. The next one is based on law passed by the parliament. Based on law passed by the Parliament. Okay, so now the question is regarding under the constitution. Okay, the question is regarding under the constitution. So whatever provisions that are listed in article 102, they will be considered as disqualification criteria under the constitution. Okay, for example, office of prophet, if he is of mentally unsound mind, or if he is declared as undischarged insolvent. Okay, so these are the provisions which will be termed as disqualification under the provisions of constitution. All the other things, right, if there is any law passed by the parliament, for example RPA Act 1951, this will disqualify members based on certain election offenses as well as failure to report election expenses within stipulated time. All these will come under RPA Act. Even if the person is getting disqualified under RPA Act, he will not be disqualified based on constitution. He will be disqualified based on law passed by the parliament. There is a difference here. Okay, you have to read the question very carefully. Okay, so the answer for this question is D, 1 and 4 only. Okay, so 2 and 3, right, these two are election offenses which have been which has been selected as a criteria for disqualification under RPA of 1951. Okay, MPs will be disqualified for these offenses, but they are mentioned in Parliamentary Act, not in Constitution. Okay, everyone, see, time's up for this question. Okay, you've given the correct answer. The answer for this question is D, fold mountains. See, how do fold mountains form? When convergent plate boundaries, okay, they meet with each other. Convergent plate boundaries, they meet with each other. Okay, it will cause tension and they will, this plate boundaries, they will bulge. Okay, these plate boundaries, they will bulge. Okay, but if it is bulged too far, okay, one plate will form, it will overhang over another plate. Okay, if it is bulged too far, one plate will overhang another plate. Okay, this part, right, this overhanging part is called as overhanging plate. This part is called as napping. Okay. Now, fold mountains are generally formed by large scale earth movements when stresses are set up in the earth's crust. When such stresses are initiated, the rocks are subjected to compressive forces that produce wrinkling or folding along the line of weakness. The upfolded waves are called anticlines and the troughs or downfolds are called as synclines. When the crest of a fold is pushed too far, an overfold is formed. If it is pushed still further, it becomes a recumbent fold. In extreme cases, fractures may occur in the crest. So the upper part of recumbent fold slides forward over the lower part along a thrust plane, forming an overthrust fold. The overriding portion of this thrust fold is termed as napping. So the option is D for this question. Okay. Neelam, you're given the answer is C. Okay, Neelam, you're given the answer is B. Okay, see, the answer for this question is D, right? The answer for this question is D. Okay, this statement is wrong. So far, there is no methanol blending program. There is only ethanol blending program. But NITI Aayog is contemplating the usage of methane as alternative fuel. See, methanol is a low-carbon hydrogen carrier fuel. It can be produced from high ash coal, agricultural residue, CO2 from thermal power plant and natural gas. Now, methanol, although slightly lower in energy content than petrol and diesel, can replace both petrol and diesel in transport sector as well as energy sector. In the process of heating modules, tractors, commercial vehicles and retail cooking, replacing LPG partially. Kerosene as well as wood charcoal, hence statement 1 is correct. Okay. Now, methanol, it burns efficiently in all internal combustion engines, produces negligible particulate matter as well as soot, almost nil sulfur dioxide as well as NOx emissions. Yeah, one of the reasons why methanol has the potential to be an enduring solution to human energy needs is because the bleached out CO2 both from methanol while producing methanol can be tapped back to produce methanol, thereby a seamless loop of CO2 sequestration cycle is created to perpetually burn fuels without polluting the environment at all. So CO2 from steel plants, thermal power plants, cement plants can be tapped into large quantities to produce methanol. So hence statement 2 is correct. Now the government of India launched ethanol blended program in January of 2003 for a supply of 5% ethanol blended petrol. At present, the ethanol blending percentage of petrol is around 6.3%. However, the methanol blending of petrol in India is almost negligible in India. Hence, statement 3 is not correct. NITI Aayog has drawn out a comprehensive plan to replace 20% of crude oil imports from methanol alone. Adopting methanol in this scale would bring down pollution in the country by more than 40%, and not to forget the benefits from import substitution. Almost 80% of our fuel, right, oil and gas resources, we are importing from other countries. Okay, importing from other countries. So if you are substituting this huge amounts of imports that we are importing because of oil and natural gas, we can reduce our imports to a larger extent. Okay, so it will, it's another form of import substitution. What is the meaning of import substitution? We will look at what are the commodities that we are importing right now. Okay. So we will look at those commodities and then they will replace these commodities with domestic requirements. That is called as import substitution. Now please give an answer for this next question, everyone. Okay, everyone, see, the answer for this question is A, 1 and 3 only. The second statement is wrong because it is mentioned in Article 87 itself. Okay, this is mentioned in Article 87 itself. So, it is mentioned in the Constitution itself. See here, Lok Sabha, the term of Lok Sabha is 5 years, right? So, every year on this first year, second year, third year, fourth year. Okay, so on a meeting of every year, President will address a joint session of the parliament. Okay, President will address a joint session of the parliament. This is called as President's address to the parliament. Alright. Now, this President address, it will list out what are the achievements done by the government and what are the future plans for the Indian country. Okay. So, this President address, it will be, after this President address, this address will be tabled to the parliament. And if this President address is not passed by the parliament, okay, then this is considered as no confidence motion against the government, then the government will be dissolved. Okay, so President address, it has to be compulsorily passed by the both the houses of the parliament. Okay, see, Article 87 provides for the special address of the President, hence statement 2 is not correct. Now, clause 1 of that article provides that at the commencement of first session of each general election to the House of the People and at the commencement of first session of each year, the President shall address both the houses of the parliament assembled together and inform the parliament of the causes of its summons. Such an address is called a special address and it is also an annual feature. No other business is transacted till the President has addressed the both the houses of parliament assembled together. Hence, statement 1 is correct. Now, this address has to be to the both the houses of the parliament assembled together if at the time of commencement of the first session of the year, Lok Sabha is not in existence and has been dissolved. Rajya Sabha has to meet. Rajya Sabha can have its session without the President address. This happened in 1977 when the dissolution of Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha had its session on 28th of February 1977 without the President address. Hence, statement 3 is also correct. Now, this address of President corresponds to speech of Thorne in Britain. It is discussed in both the houses of parliament on a motion called as motion of thanks. This motion is put to vote and must be passed in the house, Lok Sabha. Otherwise, it amounts to as defeat of the government. Please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answers, everyone. Please give your answers. Okay, everyone. Since D. Gautam Neelam has given answers, D. Gautam has given answers. See, the answer for this question is A. The answer for this question is A. Only the first statement is correct. Both the other statements are wrong. Okay. See, statement 1 is correct because Guru Tej Bahadur was the 9th Guru of 10 Sikh Gurus in Sikh region. He was a contemporary of Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. In the late 17th century, Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb imposed the Sharia law across his empire and an additional jizya tax on non-Muslim. It also believed that he forcibly converted many people to Islam. According to Sikh tradition, some Kashmiri Pandits spread these forced conversions and sought refuge with Guru Tej Bahadur. On the insistence of his son, the 9th Guru travelled to Delhi to dissuade Aurangzeb from his religious imposition. Aurangzeb beheaded Guru Tej Bahadur in 1675 in front of a massive crowd. Okay, so Aurangzeb is a massive it's massively very religious fanatic. Okay, unlike other Mughal emperors like Akbar as well as Shah Jahan, Aurangzeb is a religious fanatic. Now, statement 2 is not correct because Guru Granth Sahib comprises of 974 hymns composed by Guru Nanak, 64 hymns by Guru Angad Dev, 907 hymns by Guru Amar Das, 679 hymns by Guru Ram Das, and 106 hymns by Guru Tej Bahadur. So, second statement, it says that only Sikh Guru who has not composed is not part of Guru Granth Sahib. It is wrong because he was also a part of Guru Granth Sahib. Now, statement 3 is not correct because Guru Gobind Singh started the Khalsa tradition after his father Guru Tej Bahadur was beheaded during Islamic Sharia rule of Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. Guru Gobind Singh created and initiated the Khalsa as a warrior with duty to protect the innocent from any form of religious persecution. Okay, so that's it for this question. Please give your answer for the next question. Okay, everyone, the answer for this question is A. Okay, Rupali, Bocham, you have given the correct answer. Even Neelam, you have given the correct answer. The answer for this question is A. See, ISTEM is an Indian Science Technology Engineering Facilities map. The portal will act as a gateway for researchers and users to locate facilities that are required for their research as well as development work. Now, this web access will foster efficient and optimal use of equipment and capabilities as well as enable cooperation and collaboration in R&D community in both academic as well as industrial level. Okay. Now, through iSTEM portal, one can make a reservation with using it. With this, startups can leverage public and private partnerships and come up with successful services as well as products. Okay, so if I want to test any product, for example, I am taking research in a private company. Okay, now to test this research, I need some equipment. That equipment is in one R&D institution. It is freely available. Not freely available. It is not being used currently. Okay, so using this iSTEM portal, I can reserve. Okay, I can reserve that particular equipment. So using that, the R&D facility can also earn some money, and it will also foster a private public private partnership arrangement in R&D field. Okay. Please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, see, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question, okay, Ashok Kannam, you have given the answer as C. Gautam Gochamswala, you have given the answer as 2 and E. Even Rupali, you have given the answer as B. Okay, none of you have given the correct answer. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D, neither 1 nor 2. See, the Turks deliberately avoided the representation of human and animal figurines for decoration of walls because it was considered as un-Islamic. Okay, so the first question statement is wrong. Now, rather they used geometrical and floral designs along with Quran verses, it was called as arabesque. Now, Hindu motifs like bell, lotus, swastik were also frequently used, hence statement 1 is not correct. Now, in the buildings, arch and domes method was used on a wide scale. Okay. Now, however, it was not a Turkish invention. The Arabs borrowed it from Rome through Byzantine Empire. Now, it was developed by them and used by them as per their own requirements. The dome provided a pleasing skyline, and with passage of time, the domes got more loftier. Further, the use of fine quality light mortar became popular with the arrival of Turks. Hence, the statement 2 is not correct because it was an invention of Romans, not Turkish people. Okay, people, give your answer for this question. Okay, Gocham has given the answer as A. Shruti has given the answer as A. Rupali has given the answer as C. Okay, time's up, everyone. See, the answer for this question is C, both 1 and 2. Okay, it's the first statement, it's pretty obvious. Almost 90% of India's external trade by volume is handled via maritime transport. So this statement is obviously correct. And second statement is also correct because 100% FDI via automatic rule is allowed for investment in harbor construction as well as port maintenance projects. So this statement is also correct. So the answer for this question is both 1 and 2. Now please give an answer for the next question, everyone. Please give an answer for this question also. I am also given, okay, sorry, Neelam, I didn't see your answer, sorry for that, my mistake, apologies regarding that. Okay, time's up, everyone. See the answer, okay, no one has given the answer correctly. Rupali, D, it's not correct. Okay, the answer for this question is A, Unani. The answer for this question is A, Unani. See, Unani is system originated in Greece. It was introduced in India by Arabs as well as Persians sometimes around 11th century, because there is a misconception around Yunani that it was introduced by, it is an exclusive invention of Islamic practices. It is not correct. It was invented during Greek era. Now, the foundation of Yunani system was laid by Hippocrates. The basic theory of Yunani system is based upon well-known four humor therapies of Hippocrates. This presupposes the presence in the body of four humors, which via blood, yellow bile as well as black bile. Now, the human body is considered to be made up of following seven components according to Yunani. Four elements, that is air, earth, fire, water, which make up the human body. Temperature of the individual, humors, that is blood, phlegm, yellow bile as well as black bile. Organs of human body, spirits, a gaseous substance. Faculties, that is natural power and psychic power and vital power and functions of organs. So, according to Yunani, all these are components of human bodies, which is according to scientific, based on scientific evidence, it is absolutely not correct. But that's the belief of Yunani medicine system. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Please give your answer for the next question. Neelam, you are correct, given the correct answer for the last question, Neelam. Gocham has given the answer as C. Okay. Other people, please give your answer. Rupali has given the answer as A. And then, okay. See, the answer for this question is A. The answer for this question is A. It is a threat to native flora in southern states of India. See, Senna spectabilis is a plant species of legume family which is native to South and Central America. The trees prefer to grow in moist, deciduous forests. Their habitats include rainforest, semi-deciduous and dry forest, montane forests, and as well as dry valleys. Now, the plant requires full sunlight and well-drained soil to grow. Okay, so the Medumalai Tiger Reserve is facing a threat of invasive species of this Senna spectabilis, which is making incursions into the reserve from neighboring Kerala and Bandipur. Now, the trees are seen in both core as well as the buffer areas of Medumalai Tiger Reserve, with parts of Nilakottai, Karugudi, Singara and Masinagudi ranges being affected. The spread of these invasive plants, especially Senna spectabilis, poses a major threat to forest areas of Nilgiri biosphere. Now, Kerala Forest Research Institute, who conducted a study on invasive plants, have developed some physical and chemical measures to tackle the threat of this plant. So, the answer for this question is A. Okay. Anand Rajavat, you have given the correct answer. Okay, the answer is A. Santosh Shantini, you have given the wrong answer. The correct answer is A. Please give your answer for this next question. Okay, Shantini only have given has given the answer. No one else has given their answer. Please give her answer, everyone. Please give her answer. Okay. Kocham has given the answer as A. See here, the answer for this question is B. The answer for this question is B. Okay, as I mentioned in my previous classes, most of the times, clear. Partition of India was not mentioned until Mountbatten plan. Okay, it was not mentioned right until Mountbatten plan. Okay, so this one is wrong. Okay, now right until Mountbatten plan, since the idea was to keep both India and Pakistan under unified structure, British government was proposing weak center and strong provinces. So this one is also wrong. Now the third one is correct. The Constituent Assembly will be organized along democratic lines. So the answer for this question is B, 3 only. Okay. Now the cabinet mission recommended an undivided India and turned down the Muslim League demand for separate Pakistan. Also, cabinet mission restricted the communal representation. It provided that all members of interim cabinet would be Indians and there would be minimum interference from the Viceroy. It also provided for the formation of Constituent Assembly on democratic principles of population. It recognized Indian right to secede from the Commonwealth. Now, the Union Government and its legislature were to have limited powers dealing with finance, foreign affairs, as well as communication, and most of the residuary powers will be given to provincial governments. Now, the Union would have the powers necessary to raise the finance to manage the subjects. Thus, Cabinet Mission proposed a weak center. All the subjects other than Union subjects and all residuary powers would be vested in the provinces. The princely states would retain all subjects as well as all residuary powers. A Constituent Assembly will be formed of the representatives of provincial assemblies and princely states. Each province had to be allocated a number of seats in proportion to its population. The Constituent Assembly had to comprise 292 members from British provinces and 93 members from princely states. Okay. So apart from that, the representation of provincial legislatures was to break up into three sections. Section A will consist of Madras, UP, Central Provinces, Bombay, Bihar, Orissa. Section B will comprise of Punjab, Sindh, Northwest Frontier Provinces, Balochistan. Section C will comprise of Assam and Bengal. So thus it seemed that though the cabinet mission plan rejected the idea of separate Pakistan, yet it grouped the provinces in such a way that it gave weightage to the idea of Pakistan because Section B would get almost complete autonomy. Now, please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, so apart from this question, only two questions are remaining, everyone. Apart from this question, only two questions are remaining. This is a very short test, okay, compared to that. That's why I call this test as mini mock test. That's why I call this test as mini mock test, okay. Okay, Shantini only have given answer, has given the answer. Okay, anyone else please give your answer. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D, Karnataka. It's not Andhra Pradesh, Shantini. Okay, see, Tugalu Gombayata is a puppet show unique to the state of Karnataka, India. Now, Tugalu Gombayata translates to a play of leather dolls in native language of Kannada. It is a form of shadow puppetry. Karnataka Chitrakala Parishad has undertaken research on this art and has good collection of leather puppets as well. Okay, so the answer for this question is D. Now, please give your answer for the next question. Okay, see, time's up everyone. See, time's up everyone. The answer for this question is not C, Gocham. The answer is D, district located anywhere in the country. See, if you look at parliament, if you look at Indian parliament, there are two types of members in Indian parliament. One is elected members, other one is nominated members. Okay, other one is nominated members. Now, for elected members of Lok Sabha, they can select a district from their own district. They will select village from their own district for the development. Now for Rajya Sabha MP, they will select from the state that they are nominated from. Is it clear? For Rajya Sabha, they will select the state from which they are getting nominated from. But for nominated members of both Lok Sabha as well as Rajya Sabha, these people can take, they can choose any village. They can choose village, any village throughout India. They can choose any village throughout India. So that's how MP LAD scheme operates. So the answer for this question is D, district located anywhere in the country. Okay. So the members of Parliament Local Area Development Division is entrusted with the responsibility of implementation of MP LADs. Under this scheme, each MP has a choice to suggest to the district collector for the works to the tune of 5 crore rupees per annum to be taken up in his or constituency. Now the Rajya Sabha members of the parliament can recommend works in one or more districts in the state from where he is being elected. Now the nominated members of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha may select any one or more districts from any one state in the country for implementation of their choice of work under the scheme. Now the ministry has issued the guidelines on MP LAD scheme, including the implementation and monitoring of the scheme. Okay. Now, this is the last question for today, everyone. This is the last question for today. So, please give your answer. This is the last question for today. So, take as much time as possible and give your answer for this question. Shantini has given the answer as D. Okay, time's up everyone. See, the answer for this question is D. The answer for this question is D, 1, 2 and 3. All these three factors can alter the ecosystem productivity in a particular region. Okay, so the answer for this question is D. Hydrological conditions, okay, the water rainfall condition is very important for survivability of certain plants as well as animals. So this is correct. Rate of photosynthesis, this is also correct. It will regulate the carbon stock in a ecosystem. Is it clear? Rate of photosynthesis, it will regulate the carbon stock in a particular region. Marine upwelling, this is also correct. So the answer for this question is D, 1, 2 and 3. Okay, so that's it everyone for this mini mock test series. Okay, these are the questions. Okay, so if you have any doubts so far, we can ask in the comments chat section and I will try to answer those doubts. Okay, I will give you 1 to 2 minutes to ask your doubts. After that, I will end this stream. Please give your answer for the next question, everyone. Okay, please ask your doubts, everyone. If you're not asking your doubts, I will move on to the next part. Okay, you're welcome Shantini. If you have any doubts, please ask your doubts, Shantini. Okay, tomorrow I have a class on Indo-China relations. Okay, tomorrow I have a class on Indo-China relations at 11 p.m. Sorry, 11 a.m. At tomorrow 11 o'clock, I will have a class on Indo-China relations. Here I will discuss all the issues concerned with Indo-China relations, border skirmishes, economic problems. All these problems I will discuss in this class. Okay, so tomorrow at 11 a.m. I have this class. Usually my classes will be on 8 p.m. or 8:30 p.m. Okay, usually my classes will be on 8 or 8:30 p.m. So please do follow Unacademy's channel. Now this is my profile name in Unacademy, Aravind V 8155. So please do follow my profile in Unacademy app, Shantini. Okay, this is my profile ID in Unacademy app, Aravind V 8155. Aravind V -8155. So please give your follow in Unacademy app as well. Okay. So people, I think I have given you ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so far none of you have asked any doubts. Okay, so I assume that everyone is clear with the concepts and no one has any gripes with the questions asked. Okay, so thank you everyone. Have a wonderful day. Have a good night's sleep. Meet you tomorrow at 11 a.m. for Indo-China relations. Okay, so goodbye. Have a wonderful day.